Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service on this, the 12th Sunday of the year, and also on Father's Day. I'm sure that you are pleased to see that I'm in our space, and I want to assure you that all is well. It's 31 peace, and we look forward to the day when we can be together, socially distant, of course, but together in our space. The Lord be with you. Praise the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Our first worship song is Mighty to Save.
Heroes and conquerors.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us confess our sins, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with our neighbor. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon our sins, and set us free from him. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The collect for today. Lord Jesus Christ, you tell us not to be afraid. Challenge us to abandon ourselves. Encourage us to risk the sacrifice that you may find the abundant life you promise. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit in the unity of the Blessed Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 to 21. The child grew and was weaned, and on the day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. And she said to Abraham, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac." The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son. But God said to him, "Do not be so distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the slave into a nation also, because he is your offspring." Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down under a bough shoot away, for she thought, "I cannot watch the boy die." And as she sat there, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid." God had heard the boy crying as he lies there. "Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. Hear the word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 86, verses 1 to 10 and 16 to 17. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, Lord, for I put my trust in you. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. When I am in distress, I call to you, because you answer me. Among the gods there is none like you. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will call and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. For you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Show your strength in behalf of your servant. Save me because I serve you just as my mother did. Give me a sign of your goodness, that my enemies may see it and be put to shame. For you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The hymn before the Gospel is Thank You for the Cross.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came, gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love. Thank you.
Listen to the good news proclaimed in the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 10, beginning at verse 24 to 39. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers, and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebul, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the light. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. This is the Gospel of Christ. The story of how Father Abraham came to have many sons and become the father of many nations does not make Sarah and Abraham look very good. Who is this Hagar? The story can be told without mentioning her name. She is a bit of an embarrassment. The foreign slave girl who Abraham slept with and who gave birth to his firstborn son Ishmael. In fact, from Sarah's perspective, Hagar and Ishmael are clearly a problem to be dealt with. They need to be managed and eventually discarded. She and her son are in the way. Hagar and Ishmael must go. A story is told of a man who lived a full life, and when he passed away, his wife, who thought she knew him well, was shocked to learn of the other children whom he had fathered before they were married. I will leave it to your imagination as to what happened at the funeral when his other children also arrived to pay their last respects to their father. This is not an unheard of incident. It happens in our own families and causes so much pain. The theme of fear and uncertainty is recognizable in both the texts from the Hebrew Bible and the Gospel reading for today. We recognize this fear in Sarah to protect Isaac's inheritance. It could be that Isaac, having survived infancy, is no longer necessary to keep Ishmael around as a backup plan, just in case Isaac died. But Ishmael was now in the way. As the oldest son, Ishmael would have been entitled to a double portion of Abraham's inheritance. And certainly he would have occupied the place of pride amongst Abraham's sons. So as such, Sarah focuses on rather safeguarding Isaac's power and his privilege, not so much his well-being and his safety. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus recognizes that fear will also cause the failure of discipleship. Jesus' disciples courageously left the security of their homes and families to follow him as they proclaim the reign of God. But they too will know and ultimately bow to the power of fear. Faithful proclamation and practice of the gospel inevitably puts the disciples on a collision course with the powers of the world. So as Jesus prepares his disciples for mission to be the lost sheep of Israel, he is realistic about the threats that they will face. But at the same time, he builds a case for why they should not let fear become the masters of their witness. Back to Hagar and Sarah. Why does God say yes to Sarah's request to send Hagar and Ishmael away if her motivation is not noble? The text doesn't tell us. However, based on God's attention and care for Hagar and Ishmael in this chapter, it seems clear that God is not simply trying to dispose of them or get rid of them. In their distress, God heard their cries and provided the means for their survival. And even though Ishmael is not the child who would carry forward God's covenant promises, God has a plan for Hagar and Ishmael. They would also become a great nation, much like Isaac, and God would be with them. By God's grace and intervention, Hagar and Ishmael would survive. They would thrive and they would flourish. What do the narratives of Abraham and Sarah have to do with us today? What do they contribute to our understanding of God's mission in the world? The main theme of the narratives in Genesis is the fulfillment of the promises that God makes to Abraham and to Sarah in Genesis chapter 12. The promises of children, of land, and of blessing. But we would be mistaken if we believed that God only had eyes on those who were selected to be God's chosen people. Scattered throughout the stories of the Old Testament are stories of God's chosen people, but there are also people who are not chosen. Stories of Lot, stories of Hagar and Ishmael, and stories of Esau, those who had not been chosen. Yet in each case, God is very present in their lives. These stories help us to understand the misconceptions among the people of God about being chosen. Our chosenness as people of faith does not mean that we have a corner on God. It does not mean that God's love and care is limited to us. What is striking about Isaac and Ishmael is that God makes the same promise to both of them. They would each become a great nation. They would each experience God's presence and God's blessing. And if you haven't worked it out yet, Isaac becomes the leader of the nation of Israel, and Ishmael becomes the leader of the people of Islam. The difference, though, between Isaac and Ishmael is not so much chosenness, but calling. Isaac and his children are called to take the task of being the means through which God would bless the nations. They were to model a faithful relationship with God, to show the world what a relationship like that would look like. What it would mean to live out God's will for God's creation. They were to show and to tell God's love for the whole world. And ultimately, they were to participate in God's redemptive work by being the people through whom the Messiah of the world would come. God loves the Hagars and the Ishmaels of this world. God hears their cries and he sees their suffering. and brings about their redemption. We cannot and shouldn't be fearful of those whom we think are not chosen by God, and so we shy away from ministering to them. In the Gospel text, Jesus highlights the horrors that await the disciples, naming aloud the suffering that will be endured, and its causes is the first step in freeing them from the grip of fear. Think about it. When you name your fear, it's like the release of the anxiety that you had about it, because you know what it is and you are able to recognize it before it paralyzes you. The claim that whatever is covered up will be uncovered and secrets made known is another fear that many of us have, because we know that it will bring some kind of suffering. But Jesus emphasizes that the gospel must now be proclaimed in the light and from the housetops, because by living and proclaiming the gospel, they have the most powerful tool to use against the powers of this world. Why? Because Jesus is not of this world. The threat of death may be the most powerful form of fear. We are all afraid to die. And now more so because of COVID-19. We don't know who it will take next. Jesus' next expression of reassurance addresses this fear directly in Matthew 10:28-31. The right to kill is one of the main ingredients of human political power. People threaten to kill other people in this country every day. In fact, they don't threaten, they do it. Gang members kill other gang members. Partners and spouses kill each other. Every 3 minutes, a woman or a child is murdered in this country. Jesus admits that humans exercise this power, but Jesus notes also that they have the power only to kill the body, not the whole person. God alone can destroy both body and soul, and therefore God alone is the one whom we should fear. Then Jesus goes on and reassures the disciples that God is not like the powers that we are familiar with. God knows and cares even for the sparrows that are sold 2 for a penny. God knows even the hairs on our heads better than we do. The threat of violence and death are real concerns for the disciples, as they are for us. But they are no longer the determining forces in their lives, for the one who has ultimate power over our whole being exercises that power with love and with mercy. In Matthew 10:32-39, the disciples are again encouraged to remain firm in their commitment to Jesus and in their mission, even when that mission creates inevitable conflicts, especially within their families. Although Jesus has called the disciples to be peacemakers, his mission does not bring peace, but a sword. Jesus promises to bring peace, but that peace will come at violent cost. We just need to look at the world right now, at the Black Lives Matter campaign, at the racism in schools and everywhere else, at gender-based violence, at violence in the name of peace. And Jesus says, do not be afraid. I'm sure by now you're thinking Jesus was delusional. As followers of Jesus, the call on us to be disciples goes as far as to question our allegiance to our parents and the way that they have raised us, if it is contrary to the teachings of Jesus. Who of us would dare to reprimand our parents or grandparents for making racist jokes? It's okay to make jokes about one of the cousins who may be gay, or to shush the younger child when they mention that they saw their father beating their mother. These are the very things that Jesus is teaching us to speak up against and to act upon. Taking up the cross means that we identify with those who live on the margins. But Jesus promises that those who lose their life for him will in fact find it, while those who find their lives in this world will lose it. The answer to fear is that we recognize the illusion of human power, that we recognize the fear that humans have over us and hold over us, even these rooted in the threat of death. We need to be aware of the conflict and the division that the gospel produces, and we need to be especially aware of the deep conviction that God is present in the world, in mercy and in compassion, just as God was with Hagar and with Ishmael. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus Christ, you travel through towns and villages, curing every disease and illness. At your command, the sick were made well. Come to our aid now, during the global spread of the coronavirus, that we may experience your healing love. Heal those who are sick with the virus. May they regain their strength and health through quality medical care. We pray for those known to us who have been infected with the coronavirus. Heal us from our fear, which prevents nations from working together and neighbors from helping one another. Heal us from our pride, which can make us claim invulnerability to a disease that knows no borders. Jesus Christ, healer of all, stay by our side in this time of uncertainty and sorrow. Be with those who have died from the virus. May they be at rest with you in your eternal peace. Be with the families of those who are sick or have died. As they worry and grieve, defend them from illness and despair. May they know your peace. Be with the doctors, nurses, researchers, and all medical professionals who seek to heal and help those affected, and who put themselves at risk in the process. May they know your protection and peace. We pray for members of our church who are frontline workers. Jesus, keep them safe and vigilant. May they be assured of our prayers and gratitude for the sacrifices they are making to keep our people safe. Be with the leaders of all nations. Give them the foresight to act with charity and true concern for the well-being of the people they are meant to serve. Give them the wisdom to invest in long-term solutions that will help prepare for or prevent future outbreaks. May they know your peace as they work together to achieve it on earth. We pray especially for the political divisions in our own country and the corruption that is poisoning our leaders. Anoint our leaders with your Holy Spirit so that they may learn servant leadership, which Jesus embodied. Whether we are home or abroad, surrounded by many people suffering from this illness, or only a few, Jesus Christ, stay with us as we endure and mourn, persist and prepare. In place of our anxiety, give us your peace. We pray for more urgent steps to be taken by our government to combat gender-based violence. Help our nation to treat this pandemic with the urgency that it deserves. We pray against this war that is destroying the lives of women and children. Merciful God, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. For us it becomes the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, To your goodness, we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. For us it becomes the cup of salvation. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of the evil one and banish the darkness of sin and death. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. And now with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, who on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is broken for you." In the same way he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory of me." So we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Remembering therefore his death and resurrection, we bring before you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon this celebration of your Holy Church and gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honour are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. As Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray in the language of our choice. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ? We who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. The body of Christ, the blood of Christ. Give thanks to the Lord, for God is gracious. We pray together, Almighty God, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. In Jesus Christ our Lord, in the power of the Holy Spirit, enable us to live to your praise and glory. Amen. God bless Africa, protect our children, transform our leaders, heal our communities, restore our dignity, and give us peace. For Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And so, to a troubled world, peace from Christ. To a searching world, love from Christ. To a waiting world, hope from Christ. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Our concluding song is, "Who Am I?" have a very special and wonderful Father's Day to those who celebrate and to those who will remember with fondness the fathers who have gone before. Have a special day and a healthy week.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I